was Saturday morning, July 24th, 1915. Employees of the Western Electric Hawthorne Works facility out in Cicero had purchased tickets to attend probably the biggest event for the year. 3-hour cruise across the southern tip of Lake Michigan, an all-day picnic with all sorts of dancing, sports events, and then to top all that off, they had a 3-hour return moonlit cruise back to Chicago. So it was a very festive, very highly anticipated day for thousands of first and second generation immigrant employees. And suddenly, in a matter of 5 minutes after boarding, the ship rolled over into the river. And what was to have been a very festive and just an amazing day for thousands of people turned into the absolute worst, most tragic day of their lives. If you can imagine a scene where you've got 2,500 people immediately thrown into the Chicago River, 2/3 of them survive, 1/3, 844 of them perish. The ship, from its original design and construction, through all the years of various modifications, was unstable and top-heavy. And to add to that, that morning, they did two other things that aggravated that, that complicated that instability. They emptied out the water ballast tanks, which were at the very bottom levels of the ship, so all that weight was eliminated, which raised the center of gravity. And then they also boarded more than 2,500 passengers that day. Prior to that, during the 1915 season, they had carried upwards of 1,100. So that morning, they actually had more than double the greatest number that they had previously that season. And of course, the passengers are all boarding to the topmost decks of the ship. So your center of gravity, because of those two things, went from being at a certain point on the ship to being much higher on the ship, and that's one of the things that will cause a ship to capsize. The tragedy itself was pretty much over in 5 minutes. Once the ship decided to roll, there was no stopping it, there was no going back. It rolled in the river, and within a matter of probably 5 minutes or less, you either survived or you didn't. But then there's this incredible aftermath of rescue and recovery and relief that carries on for hours and days, weeks, even months. Firemen and policemen were the first to arrive at the scene. The U.S. Coast Guard was dispatched. They had volunteer divers that came on to assist the professional divers to go into the hull. Chicago had never dealt with a tragedy of that magnitude before. The Cook County coroner, Peter Hoffman, comes on the scene and realizes he has a situation here that's just nothing like he's ever experienced. So he commandeered basically the 2nd Regiment Armory Building and used that to consolidate all these other temporary makeshift morgues that had been established. The motion picture film footage that was discovered in February, the digitized versions of it, was just an incredible find. For the first time ever, we got as close, I think, as we'll ever get to really having a sense for what it was like to be part of that. The photos that we've been looking at from the Chicago Tribune look to be, for me at least, they're not motion picture footage, but it's historic record that's never been seen before. There's hundreds of photos that are out there. Most of them we've seen before. This is all brand new.
We did find the pictures about 6 months ago. There is a fifth floor sub-basement that we travel to in the Tribune Tower. It's 5 floors below Michigan Avenue, and there are over 60,000 glass plate negatives. We do have a digital searchable archive of the glass plates, and we have to search through all that. We find what we're looking for. These particular boxes, the Eastland boxes, we weren't searching for them. We were down there looking for something else. We're lucky that it was written on the back of the box, because I saw the box that said Eastland. And I thought, oh my gosh, it's gotta be the disaster. What else is gonna say that? There, in the collection that we have, there's 2 boxes that we found, and there's 95 glass plate negatives in there. Most of these photos have never been printed. That we have knowledge of. The photos themselves are much different because they're actually documentary photos rather than posed pictures, which is what we usually find posed photos from that time period. that is usually due to the technology of the time from the cameras. The cameras were big and bulky, and they couldn't handle a lot of motion blur. When the disaster happened, it was so close to a lot of news sources. So I think there were seven or more newspapers right there where the photographers could just grab their cameras and run. This is a well-documented tragedy because of how the close proximity. And it's probably one of the first in our area that was well-documented like this. When you see the photo of the bodies lined up in the morgue, you know, the number 844 killed in the disaster, it becomes a number after some period of time. You know, you've heard it a long time if you know of the Eastland. But when you see the photo of the bodies lined up in the morgue, you really get the graphic sense of what a horrible tragedy this was. For me, looking at it, there were so many young women and children that were in that did not survive. A lot of that, I think, had to do with the clothing that they were wearing at the time, too. Such heavy clothes, they were just taken under. And a lot of survivors said that that was a really hard thing to get past. I think it's important for us to be able to show these pictures, knowing that, you know, there's no survivors that are living right now that can see these, but to be able to show the history of Chicago and have it 100 years later still be as important as it was back then, I think is really important today to do.